I think in the grand scheme of things, I think we're going the wrong way as in the big picture of human beings. I don't see, I wish I had a different outlook, you know, but I try to not to be too gloomy and let it ruin my day and ruin my life. You know, I try to not get, because if you really get involved in the stuff and you pay too much attention to all the politics and stuff, it just weighs you down. And it just really affects your whole being. And I can't have that, man. Time is too precious and too short. And there's
Hi, Alex. How are you?
How are you doing, my friend? It's Tommy, though.
Okay. No problem. Could you repeat, please, your name?
Tommy. Tomas.
Tommy. Tomas. Oh, my
yes,
God.
Sir.
Fine. It's a very common name here in Argentina.
Indeed. I bet, man. Nice to see you.
Fine, nice to see you too. We are here thanks to lacuna.org, and we want to talk about your music and
we just do it. I like being close to the water. I like being close to the mountains. There are good things that you can share and experience, you know, relationships, love, music, nature, a bond with animals, you know, healthy living, good vibes, you know, exercise, you know, taking care of yourself. There's good things to be said and to be experienced. And I'd much rather focus on those things, you know. I vibe with animals much more than I do with humans, especially these days, you know. It's just a choice I made. Now it's second nature to me, you know. I mean, I went vegetarian many, many years ago. Kind of, it was early 90s, so it wasn't nearly as widespread as it is now. Now it's great. Now there's, you know, but when I was on tour in the early 90s over here in the States, it was hard to eat, to find a good solid vegetarian meal going across the States. Now, thankfully, it's pretty easy and everything's more widely available. Even the heinous fast food places have what they claim to be as vegetarian food, you know, whatever that is. But I had my reasons for going there. It was health related. I just wanted to feel cleaner, wanted to not contribute to the factory farming and all the pain inflicted on animals. And it just wasn't for me, man, you know. And I never looked back personally, and I feel really good about it. And I can't imagine changing ever, you know. When I got to Berkeley and Boston in 91, I was still pretty set in my, you know, hard rock metal ways, you know, and my tendencies as a musician, what I listened to, what I loved. And I still, get me wrong, I still listen to and love metal music. I go to see Iron Maiden when they come around, Judas Priest, Saxon, I love it all. I still love it. But what I've played, what I've made my career and my out of, has been more of groove-based music, reggae, dub. It's just a lot of what I got turned on to at Berkeley. I started listening to John Coltrane. I started listening to Muddy Waters. And this is not reggae dub stuff, but this just cracked open a piece of my brain and allowed a lot of other things to get in there, you know? John Coltrane, Joni Mitchell, the Sting album, Dream of the Blue Turtles, which was it was after Sting left the Police, and he had this album, Dream of the Blue Turtles, which was really jazzy, kind of amazing. The playing on it was fantastic. I just got exposed to this higher level of craftsmanship, of drumming. And it just led me to all these different places, you know? And then I fell in love with reggae, man, you know, and dub music. It just got into my veins. And I went to Jamaica and played and toured in Jamaica. Early on, after I got out of Berkeley, within a year, I was in Jamaica doing a tour. So, and since then, I've been able to back a lot of foundation Jamaican artists, you know, like Meditations, Leonard Dillon, Justin Hines, Clinton Fearon from the Gladiators, Michigan. So I've been lucky enough to back all these foundation artists, and it's just, reggae kind of just got into me at a certain time, and it just, there was so much. My friends and I, a bunch of my crew and I, were all discovering it at the same time in our, you know, early mid-20s. And we just went berserk on it. We just we would smoke up and just listen and just crank. We'd sit in his room and just turn it up so loud and let it just, you know, listen to every percussion thing, every scratch. What was in the left speaker? What was in the right speaker? We studied the production. Yeah, we were just studying. We were tearing it apart and studying every little thing about it. You know, it just was fascinating, and it still is, you know, because it's such a beautiful, rich music, and it's so masterful sonically and playing wise and songwriting wise. There's just so much to it, you know, and it's you know, it just got me. Music is the ultimate language, right? It's the universal language, you know, and we like to do, yeah, we like to do the talking through the music more than, I mean, Dub Apocalypse is an instrumental band, so we don't have lyrics even. You know, the tenor saxophone in our band is kind of like the lyricist, the vocalist. It's kind of like an expressionistic kind of jazz approach that we take, but instead of the rhythm being like jazz music, we use like dub reggae and heavy drum and bass and dub reggae as like the foundation. But over that foundation, we use the format of like jazz and expressionistic music, even some classical themes and different stuff. So we don't have the lyrics to kind of make it, people have to be more interpretive for people, you know, which is cool. You know, I've always loved instrumental music myself. So, I mean, there's not enough time in the day really to listen to the amount of music that I want to study. And, you know, during the pandemic, the first few months, myself and our horn player, we would go back and forth, and we would just immerse ourselves in classical music documentaries, Luc Debussy, Schoenberg, Bartok, and we would listen to, like, we have collections of the complete works of these artists, and it's literally lifetimes worth of listening. You know, you're talking Bach, Beethoven, like Chopin, you're talking, you could have three lifetimes and not cover all this stuff, you know. So there is so much work to do and so much listening to do and stuff to study and be inspired by. You know, I still discover, I've been playing reggae music for almost 30 years, you know, and I still discover new things on probably a weekly basis, you know, stuff from the vaults that, because they were so prolific, because in the 70s, in the mid 70s, the culture and the climate was so hot in Kingston, they couldn't play live shows. So that's why they were always in the studio making records, making tracks. That's why they're so prolific. That's why you still discover new stuff even after 50 years, you know, because that's all they could do safely was hole up in the studio and make records, you know. So it's pretty fascinating to be able to, through technology, to be able to still, you know, and record shops, whatever, to be able to find these things all these years later and still be inspired, you know.
Could you tell us, how did you find any space to mix this kind of different, very different music from the Northern Europe to Jamaica? It's a very interesting mix.
It's a weird, yeah, it's been a heavy journey, you know, because I wasn't raised on reggae music by any stretch. I was raised on rock music, you know, heavy music, heavy metal, rock music, AC/DC, Led Zeppelin, Iron Maiden, like all the, I'm sure you guys, I know Iron Maiden is big in Argentina, so.
Yes, they are very famous. Argentina is a rocker country, you know,
that you don't know. Exactly, yes. So,
for rock bands.
Yeah, man, of course. So, you know, gradually, I mean, I ended up moving to Boston in 91 to go to Berklee College of Music here in town. When I got here, it kind of really expanded my whole musical horizon. I got turned on to a lot of different stuff, met people from all over the world that were going to Berklee. And I got out of Berklee and went on tour with a reggae rock band that was friends of mine. I used to see them play here in town. I went on tour with them for a few years. That band broke up, and then out of that band, another band called John Brown's Body formed. That band I toured with for 20 years. That was an eight-piece reggae band with a full horn section, kind of modeled after like Burning Spear, Alpha Blondie, the kind of big reggae sound. And we toured for the planet for like 20 years. with that band. And out of that, you know, Dub Apocalypse was just kind of a thing I would do when I was off the road. Me and my buddies would get together when we were off the road and we'd play here at little pub shows and stuff. And, you know, we formed a little collective of people, and that's grown over the past 15 years. And Dub Apocalypse is kind of like a collective. There is a core group of like five of us that form like the band, but there's a real wider orbit of people that come in and out. And depending on who's on any given gig, it'll add a different flavor to that particular show, you know? So we get jazz players that come through, horn players, we get funk players. We have Dana Colley from Morphine, who I know has also done a ton of work down in your beautiful country. He comes in and plays Barry Sax with us. So there's a lot of tentacles out, you know? So with this many people, with this many backgrounds, we're able to draw from everybody's experience and everybody's background and influences, and compositionally add some different things to the mix, I think, than just traditional reggae. We don't play like happy, beachy reggae. You know, we play a little bit, we like it a little bit on the darker side, a little more introspective and moody kind of vibe, you know? So that's kind of where we come from. We just try to, you know, gather the
pieces
and, you know,
I got it. Yes, it's most of the bands, they most of them are like a Frankenstein.
Sure.
From older bands that, you know, create a new one. And how those tentacles mix their personalities and try to choose a creative direction when you create new music.
It's pretty much an unspoken thing. I mean, a lot of these guys in Dub Apocalypse, we've been playing music together for 20 years, so it's a very instinctive thing, you know? So now when our sax player, Timo, when he brings chord changes to the table for a tune, we kind of know what to put under. And these changes may be working off of a Bartok composition, but we mask them. We're not playing classical music, but the harmonic aspect of it and the depth of it and the flavor of it and the vibe of it, we put a heavy beat, a dub beat under that, and then it's kind of like you were saying, it's a mashup of different cultures and sounds and eras of time, and it all comes together right here in 2021, and we just kind of have our own sound from playing together, from playing so many shows, so many miles, from spending the time listening, studying together. It's just kind of an instinctual thing that happens with us, that's the beauty of music, you know, to get together. And you don't even have to talk. We just get together, I'll count them in. I started playing drums when I was probably 11 years old. And that was because I was hearing and seeing, it was right around when MTV was coming on for the first time, like 1981. Dating myself a little bit, but whatever. And I would see Van Halen videos. And I saw Alex Van Halen play the drums, and that was it, man. I was like, that's what I'm doing. So I started off on this long path that's I'm still continuing on today, you know, and it's been quite a journey. I mean, I did take, you know, start to really take it seriously as a career to do this professionally when I moved to Boston to go to Berklee College of Music. Since then, it's been full gas, you know, the whole time. I've been playing professionally for maybe 30 years at this point, you know, give or take, you know. Yeah. So yeah, it's you know, I'm trying to stay inspired and keep learning. I have a really great crew we have here in Boston that we get each other work. We play a lot, you know, and I'm so happy doing what I do, you know. It's a good thing. It's I'm pretty fortunate to still be doing it after all these years, you know. You know, my wife and I live here like 20 minutes from Walden Pond, which I don't know if you're familiar with Henry Thoreau, who's a writer, like from the Transcendentalist writer from the States over here in this area of the country. And he wrote a book called Walden. And it's just this beautiful nature reserve with a pond and just all these woods that he would live in, and he would, you know, just, you know, become one with the whole place, you know, and this is in the 1800s. And we live 20 minutes from that place, and it's like a sacred, it's like church to me, you know, it's like a sacred, not only is it the site of one of the great, greatest American works of literature, but it's just a beautiful, natural place, you know. So we go to spots like that to just tune out, you know. It's nice to have those spots to just get out of the city, tune out, not hear anything, you know, just, and that's important, you know. It's like, that's what I was saying, I love being on the ocean here. We got the ocean a couple miles away to the east. We got the mountain, the Green Mountains are up here, the White Mountains. It's just the states to be in, you know. To people and to bring people, I hope, happiness and good vibes for, you know, a few decades at this point. So, I mean, I think my mission is just to try to live good and bring as much good to this world as I can, you know? And most of it is me. I try to be a good husband for my wife, try to be a good son to my folks and a good brother to my brothers. But what has consumed me for the better part of my life has been music and traveling, making records. And that's what I'm here to do, you know? So, yeah. And it's a satisfying way to be on this planet. And so that's what I'm gonna keep doing and trying to, you know, put out the best quality, really pure music that I can do. And I don't wanna get involved in and the distractions and stuff like that. I just want to play music that I love to play and that I would love to listen to, you know, and that inspires me. And that's, if you call that a mission, then I guess I'm down with that, you know. But that's kind of just, that's what I do. It's kind of second nature at this point. Thank you. some really stunning places in here. And then of course, you know, as usual, humans go in and fuck everything up, and you know, and then they have to go down, or they'll fuck with the animal, and you know, humans are always fucking things up, essentially, you know. So, but as far as the spots, yeah, I mean, those, the national park system over here is gorgeous. Yeah, it really is, you know.
I love to talk with people that love they do, because it doesn't find people that do that, because most of them are living the routine and following the social mandatory rules, but not following their inspiration. I can realize your youngest person fighting against the society, trying to find the heavy metal bands and learning some instruments. I think it should be a very hard part at the beginning, because it's not the common hope for a father or a mother. Oh, my child is a rock star.
Yeah, totally. That's why my folks kind of, they were pushing me to take music, you know, to go to school for it, essentially. So the big sign, from them, the big sign for me saying that I was taking this seriously, and I wanted to be a musician, I wanted to work on my craft. That wasn't just about going and partying, and of course, we all do a ton of that, obviously, too, but... focusing and developing a craft and trying to hone my sound, my approach, and you know, what I could bring to the table, you know. And when I enrolled at Berkeley, my folks, I think, and I got accepted to Berkeley, I think my folks were kind of like, all right, it looks like he's signing on, he's in for the journey on this. So they, and then since then, you know, I mean, it's kind of where, you know, I've been achieved a lot of things that I would dream of as a kid. Like I've had a feature in Modern Drummer magazine, you know, that to me as a kid, if you ever told me that I would be in Modern Drummer, I would never have believed, the 11-year-old me would never believe that, you know. So all the later, you know, yeah. So I mean, and I'm still an underground musician, you know, I mean, I'm not rich and famous or anything, you know, I mean, we grind, I'm still working and grinding and playing a lot, you know, so, but that I play music that I love with people I love playing with, so what can you ask for?
Fantastic. I admire this. And a final question, please tell me, how did you move from being a heavy metal drummer to an instrument, being a player in instrumental music band? It's very that transition.
Like I said, it does have a lot to do with when I got to Berkeley and Boston in 91, I was still pretty set in my, you know, hard rock metal ways, you know, and my tendencies as a musician, what I listened to, what I loved. And I still, get me wrong, I still listen to and love metal music. I go to see Iron Maiden when they come around, Judas Priest, Saxon. I love it all. I still love it. But what I've played, what I've made my career and my out of, has been more of groove-based music, reggae, dub. It's just a lot of what I got turned on to at Berkeley. I started listening to John Coltrane. I started listening to Muddy Waters. And this is not reggae dub stuff, but this just cracked open a piece of my brain and allowed a lot of other things to get in there, you know? John Coltrane, Joni Mitchell, the Sting album, Dream of the Blue Turtles, which was a real, it was after Sting left the Police, and he had this album, Dream of the Blue Turtles, which was really jazzy, kind of amazing. The playing on it was fantastic. I just got exposed to this higher level of craftsmanship, of drumming. And it just led me to all these different places, you know? And then I fell in love with reggae, man, you know, and dub music. It's just got into my veins, and I went to Jamaica and played and toured in Jamaica. The early on, after I got out of Berkeley, within a year, I was in Jamaica doing a tour. So, and since then, I've been able to back a lot of foundation Jamaican artists, you know, Meditations, Leonard Dillon, Justin Hines, Clinton Fearon from the Gladiators, Michigan. I've been lucky enough to back all these foundation artists, and it's just, reggae kind of just got into me at a certain time, and it just, there was so much. My friends and I, a bunch of my crew and I, were all discovering it at the same time in our, you know, early mid-20s, and we just went berserk on it. We would smoke up and just listen and just crank. We'd sit in his room and just turn it up so loud and let it just, you know, listen to every percussion thing, every scratch, what was in the left speaker, what was in the right speaker. We studied the production. Yeah, we were just studying it. We were tearing it apart and studying every little thing about it. You know, it just was fascinating, and it still is, you know, because it's such a beautiful, rich music, and it's so masterful sonically and playing wise and songwriting wise. Is just so much to it, you know. And it's, yeah, it's, we have a new record coming out in 2022 for sure. We're finishing the mixing and that, and until then, yeah, we can get you, anybody around the planet can go to dubapocalypse.com. there's a bunch of music up there. We're on Instagram, dubapocalypse music, but we have a ton of content up there, a ton of music. And you know, we don't get around outside the States yet. We may someday, but right now we certainly do our fair share of playing in the Boston area, New England, in the States. So there's a lot of good stuff up there to check out if people are here to dig in.
A Soldier recording was made possible by organizations working together for people, not profits.